Hi, my name is Uli. I'm a guide with the Parramatta Heritage and Visitor Information Centre, and I also represent Parramatta Park. The cottage you see behind me was built by ex-convict George Salter in the 1790s, and it has become known as the Dairy Cottage. In truth, it was never a dairy, but the dairymaids who worked in the sunken dairy next door called it their home. One of the best known dairy maid was Betty Eccles, and this is her story. Elizabeth Bird was known as Betty and lived a rather unremarkable life in Raynham, County Essex in England, around 1787. At the age of 57, she decided to steal a lamb. She was caught, she was sentenced to hang. Her sentence was luckily commuted, and from that time on, her life took a very different path, a path of adventure and invention. Betty sailed on the Lady Penrhyn to the colony of New South Wales. Accidents and deaths were happening on a daily basis. The worst thing that befell Betty and her companions was that they were washed out of their bunks by heavy seas on a number of occasions. In Sydney town, Betty meets her future husband, convict Thomas Eccles. Thomas is sent to Norfolk Island to grow crops for the starving colony, and Betty soon follows him. In a ceremony of 100 couples, they are married on Norfolk Island by Reverend Johnson. They both are farmers, and they come to the attention of Commandant Lieutenant King. When King returns to the colony of New South Wales to take up command as governor, Betty and Thomas follow him, and they secure positions as servants at Government House at Parramatta. Betty and Thomas applied for land and were granted 1 acre along the northern side of the Parramatta River. They grew crops and vegetables, and they kept pigs. The irony is that Thomas was sent to the colony because he stole a side of bacon and 8 pounds of bread. Thomas surely must have felt in heaven, keeping his own pigs, supplying the government with pork, and I'm sure occasionally he and Betty would have indulged in a legal slice of bacon. What a change it must have been for them, having food on the table, a roof over their heads, and reasonable health in their advanced age. But it didn't last. Thomas died in 1814 and he's buried at St. John's Cemetery in Parramatta. Being female, Betty was not permitted to keep the land grant she and Thomas worked on. So at the ripe old age of 84, Betty had to reinvent herself once again, this time as a dairy maid. Not quite matching the image of a fresh-faced lass milking a cow, in fact, Betty didn't have to milk the cows. The milk was brought to her on drays, and her domain was the sunken dairy. This building was known as the Ranger's Cottage. It was built over the top of the dairy in the early 1870s, the old dairy being used as a cellar room and later on being filled in. It remained hidden until restoration works revealed its location. Prior to that, it was Betty's workplace. Betty lived next door in George Salter's cottage. By her time, it was extended to a comfortable home, which looked very much like you see it today. Milk was scalded above the fireplace next door at the dairy cottage and then brought across by the dairy maids to the sunken dairy. There was no refrigeration available at the time, so product kept fresher longer in cool rooms like this cellar, and dairies were often sunk below ground. Products like butter, cream, sour milk, buttermilk, and soft cheeses were made in the sunken dairy. And Betty would have spent endless hours churning cream in a wooden butter churn like this one. Governor Macquarie was well acquainted with Indian spices as he spent time in India before he arrived in the colony of New South Wales. Betty was taught to add spices to her soft cheeses. Her products were sent up to Government House and they were also sold at the Parramatta markets. Today we expect to buy artisan products at the farmers' markets at Parramatta, but who would have thought that Epicurean delights like Indian spices were available that early in the colonial time? Betty was making a go of her new career. However, she wanted more from life. In an extraordinary turn, she travelled to England to lobby the Prince Regent for a small pension. Why was this so extraordinary? Firstly, by the time Betty travelled, she was well into her 80s. She was an ex-convict and she was an unaccompanied female. Very few of those who arrived in the colony ever set foot on England soil again. It would have taken a lot of determination for Betty to go back and challenge the crown for her pension. What was the outcome of Betty's bold stance? She was granted a small pension for life by the Prince Regent. Now it begs the question, why did she not retire to a life of ease? Instead, she returned to Parramatta and continued her life as a dairymaid. Betty endeared herself to all the governors and their families, but especially to Governor Burke. When Betty died in 1838, he paid for her funeral. She lies at St. John's Cemetery in Parramatta. Her obituary states that she kept all her mental faculties to the end, and she died, respected by all her acquaintances, at the grand age of 105. Betty's story is one of courage and defiance, survival against the odds, and finally comfort and contentment due to her diligent work and a positive attitude right through her life. Today, Betty's home and workplace, the Dairy and Rangers Cottages, together with Old Government House and Parramatta Park, form one of 11 Australian convict sites, which are inscribed on the UNESCO World Heritage List. What would Betty make of that?